presentation is really focused on the role of private sector in publicly or government funded health insurance schemes, and as you would know that's the way the government of India proposes to achieve universal health care in our country, and it's going in a big way. And despite the existing evidence, which is well kind of culled out by Rama and Madhuri, and so there has been no evidence really that partnering with the for-profit sector is actually increasing accessibility or reducing equity. Despite that, there is a whole move to actually provide services through purchasing services from the private sector. So this is based on a study that was done by Sehat in Mumbai. We looked at the state level public insurance scheme, which is called Rajiv Gandhi Jeevandai Yojana, which is modeled on the first such state scheme which was offered by Andhra Pradesh. And despite the issues and problems with that scheme, Maharashtra decided to go ahead with it. So there's an entire study. Those findings will be reflected in the presentation. Also, there was a conference that was organized jointly by Sehat and Tata Institute. So there were about 13 papers presented at the conference. There were papers based on the central insurance scheme, which is providing secondary care. And then there are several state-level insurance schemes across 4-5 states, and there was evidence presented from all those states. So this is really culling out whatever emerged from that entire two-day discourse that we had at the conference. So I'm going to just highlight a couple of things that emerged. One is increasing availability of services through purchasing from the private sector. And what emerged across these states where these are being implemented is that it doesn't really increase availability because the private sector is really concentrated in the urban areas. So if it is about improving access to those in rural and less endowed with health services, then that's not how it is working. There was a poor access for the rural population. In Maharashtra, we found that 12 of the least urbanized districts had merely about 12% of the total empaneled hospitals. So how the scheme actually works is it empanels hospitals. So that's the way in which the empaneled hospitals were really spread. 44% of the empaneled hospitals were located in the most urbanized districts of the state. Nandurbar, which has about 65% of scheduled tribes population, had only one empaneled hospital, and that was a public hospital. Because the private sector, by its nature, because of market, it operates only in the areas where there is a paying population. Mm-hmm. No increase in availability of specialties. So although there are some 30 specialties which have to be offered by hospitals, what the Maharashtra study found was that a specialty such as medical oncology was unavailable through the private sector under the scheme in 12 districts. Intervention oncology was unavailable in 17 districts. So, things which are expensive, which, those were absolutely not available because these hospitals were not offering those services under the scheme. 40% of all the empaneled hospitals were providing about 11 to 12, 20 specialties. So basically, even if they empaneled, they were not offering all 30. And, we'll come to that. But basically, even if, as a hospital, I enter into the scheme, I select what I will offer. Mm-hmm. So it's not like if my hospital is empaneled and the population knows that, they can come, they have a card, they can come here, I may just offer a couple of services. I will not offer the whole range that I'm supposed to offer. This is the inter-district travel. So just to highlight that despite empaneling so many hospitals and a large number of them in the private sector, people had to, the pre-authorizations were raised in other districts. Mm-hmm. So it was not improving access. So they still have to travel to another district to access health mm-hmm. services. Targeting versus universal, and I think we had a huge discussion around it in the conference that was held in Tata Institute. And this entire thing about whether we have clear criteria, whether we agree with the criteria for the below poverty line, how is it working, and a lot of people are being left out because of lack of documentation, they are not able to enroll into the scheme, and this emerged from all the states. So it's true of RSBY as well as the state funded insurance scheme. Then the premise of the entire scheme, you know, it, and it's written in actually black and white about private-public competition, or, you know, so it actually empanels public and private, and it actually says that you should incentivize, So meaning, but for the private sector, it's very obvious what the incentive is. But for the public, there's a huge burden to actually, and which where doctors are actually getting into a lot of clerical work, because they have to just do this entire range of paperwork to get the reimbursements to the hospital. And there's no clarity as to what happens to that money. In fact, in states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu, they have even incentivized. So, you know, doctors get some kind of incentive if they get X number of reimbursements under the scheme. Now, you know, so what Rama said about the principles, you know, so they're bringing the same market principles into the public sector, which doesn't really work. There was a stark difference in claims by men. So in Maharashtra, we found that much of the claims were of men. We didn't have adequate data to get further into it. But a lot of other reproductive and other care is often not even offered under these schemes. So that's another issue. There was persistent out-of-pocket expenditure across all the papers that were presented and across all the states. And OPD expenses, of course, are not included at all. So it's only the tertiary, largely, which is included. RSBY includes some of the secondary care. So significant, out-of-pocket expenditure. 65% of the pre-authorization was rejected in the Maharashtra. That's what we found in Maharashtra. And when it's rejected, it means that, obviously, the patients and their families had to pay. And the reimbursement is quite, so this is just the cost of treatment. So the interstate travel and all the other expenditures, not even, you know, that anyways is incurred by the families. It was also observed that even hospitals keep sending patients back with certain health complaints, saying that when it comes to a certain, you know, when it increases, then that is offered under the scheme, so then you come back for that. So there's also that kind of irrational and very problematic unethical practice and unethical practice that was reported. There was lack of, awareness amongst the people who were interviewed. So they, what was presented at the conference were some papers where the users were also interviewed. Mm-hmm. So they didn't know about the entire scheme. Now, the other issue with this whole thing is strengthening the private sector. And if these schemes are actually just doing that. In Maharashtra, 84% of the empaneled hospitals were in the private sector, and 70% of the funds actually, I mean, the payments went to the private sector, and it's a huge amount of money. So it's like 4.4 crores and about 70 to 75% going clearly to the private sector. And when I say private sector and for profit, it's a situation where she described the entire, you know, charitable and those hospitals, which have some kind of, you know, at least on paper, they're supposed to do something, but you have a whole range of corporate hospitals and other private hospitals which are less than 30 beds who are completely unregulated. Mm. So, and when I say unregulated, I just give one example to say that if I have to set up a private hospital, all I need to do is register under shops and establishments. So, I'm actually registering a shop. So there is no accountability in terms of standard treatment protocols, no accountability in terms of physical and clinical standards. So a study that we did in Maharashtra, and I want to just bring that in to give a context of Maharashtra itself to say these are the players who are being paid by the government to provide services. Mm-hmm. And we did a study by Sehat of about 11 districts. And what we found was that 50% of the hospitals did not have a single qualified nurse. And this is data reported by hospitals, so it's not a conjecture. 50% of the hospitals did not have a full-time doctor. So this is the kind of quality of care that we are talking about, which now the government brings in and asks people to go and seek services, just to provide a context. I'll finish it. So there, again, going back, there's a selective promotion of hospitals and specialties. So they're choosing what to offer. So just to give an example from the Maharashtra study, those 17 of the these empaneled, you know, these specialities under the scheme were available, they offered only 3 to 4. Okay, so 60% of the patients under the scheme were admitted under cardiology, with the rest being distributed over oncology in some. And this is of course only in Mumbai. But that's the kind of services that they are getting and choosing. And I'll talk about it a little later. But anyway, so there's irrational care, there's evidence of rising hysterectomies. And this has been kind of well documented, so it's not massive. And what Maharashtra did was, because Andhra Pradesh had this whole issue with hysterectomies, they said, okay, hysterectomies will not be provided in the private sector. And we had some data where we found that in Nagpur district, so the only place where women can go for hysterectomies is the district hospital, and it's, you know, lined up. So, you know, if women who really need a hysterectomy cannot get it, because I mean, what would have been better is to find ways of actually regulating it, or, you know, creating more accountability mechanism. But what they've done is to keep it, okay, so hysterectomy, there is a chance of misuse, so, you know, that won't be offered under the scheme. So that's been there. This we found in the by private hospitals, where they have actually taken efforts to go create awareness. So they are holding health camps in rural areas. They go there. The promotion is not of the scheme. Promotion is of their hospital. And they actually identify cardiac patients. So it's not a general health camp where all health services under the scheme will be offered. I mean, that would have been really great, but that's not how it is. So they're picking up those who with blocks, bringing them in buses to the city of Mumbai, and providing the cardiology through under the scheme. So overall, one found that, you know, in monitoring and with very weak monitoring and regulation in Maharashtra, the empanelment is a very simple procedure. It talks about NABH standards and all of that, but there is really no way physical inspection. And when they have actually found later, and some of these inspections are done by the third party, so it's the insurance companies who are doing it. When later they have found gaps, nothing really has actually, you know, so there are notices sent, but they have not been depaneled. I think we had experience where one or two hospitals were depaneled. The high cost in the private sector, again, because there was a very interesting study presented at the conference by the IIT Madras, where they've actually been able to show that the cost of providing care in the public sector is much lower then providing the same through the private sector, through the insurance schemes. And this is just to say that, you know, doctors, or, you know, private hospitals also feel that they're doing some great service, because they feel that actually the cost is so high and the package only offers this much. So this is the IIT Madras thing, that they've actually shown that that's not true, because the it's quite comparable what is offered under the scheme by the government and what is the cost. Just to kind of, you know, this is my last slide, Brahma. So, just to kind of say that two things. One is, you know, the Delhi thing that, you know, she spoke about. And what we did in Maharashtra was we looked at charitable trust hospitals in Mumbai. We got, so these are hospitals, these are all Jaslok, all these big hospitals which are actually registered as charitable trust. For years together, they have taken all the advantages, exemptions for import of medical equipments and all of that. As part of that, on paper, and there's a whole court case where there's a clear High Court order of the Mumbai High Court, where they are supposed to provide 10% beds for the poor and another 10% for economically weak. So, you know, if you take 20% of their beds have to be provided for, and there's a whole monitoring mechanism, so they have to report on a monthly basis to the charity commissioner. What we did was in the study is that, and I have a report of that here, we collected the data that they submit to the charity commissioner and we compiled it for 3 years. And what we found was that of the 42 hospitals who were reporting, and this is out of 96 hospitals, so the rest are not even reporting, out of 42, only one hospital had provided up to some 10%, and large number of them were less than 5%. And even when we are when I'm putting out these figures, they are reporting OPD, outpatient numbers, which is not what they are supposed to do. They are supposed to actually clearly provide beds, which is inpatient service. So even if you look at that, it's less than 5%, which is about 1/4 of these 42 hospitals. So 4 or 5 of these hospitals who are providing less than 5% of what they're supposed to do. So this is the, and this is a clear, you have a mechanism by which you can make it work. That, you know, you can make the whole public-private referrals possible, but the state is not able to do that. And within that context, you have a situation where you are rolling out a huge state insurance scheme and where you really have no control. And lastly, Seven Hills Hospitals, everybody must be, you know, some of you may have read it in the newspaper. This is the biggest scandal, I think, in terms of the public-private partnerships. 17 acres of land was given by the corporation to the management, and they were supposed to set up a hospital. The President of India came, she inaugurated it. Even when it was inaugurated, the public ward had not been set up, and there's a PIL which has been filed. The terms of reference were not clear to say how this whole public sector, the hospital, you know, for the poor and whatever, will be actually demonstrated. Meaning, how will it work? And they were supposed to, as far as what we remember from the work we were doing with the PPP cell of the BMC, we were told that it's going to be in the same building, and there'll be some wards which are for the poor or for those who can't pay, and there'll be a for-profit wing. What they have done actually is, there's a whole for-profit hospital and there's a separate building. So the entire physical standards are complete. You just stand there and you'll see the difference. So this is like, you know, AC from the reception, and this is like a dilapidated building. That's how it's done. So these charitable hospitals did not want, did not empanel themselves under the Rajiv Gandhi Jeevandayi scheme, saying that we are already providing 20% of free beds. Okay.
You can't mix these people.
And this Seven Hills Hospital was the only hospital which enrolled under the scheme. So what it actually did was set up this whole building and enroll under Rajiv Gandhi. So every patient who came in was given a that card, the smart card, and all the care was reimbursed by the government of Maharashtra. So that's the kind of, you know, really, in, you know, they're actually very innovative and very smart to kind of do that. And now, of course, there's a whole case going, and they have to, you know, then they said, okay, it's not free land, you pay us some lease. So they had agreed to pay some 100 crores. Now they can't pay it. So now the government actually has asked for it. They've asked them to surrender the lease. So this just to kind of sum up to say, this is the state of affairs. And within that, when we are looking at purchasing, and now there's a new term, which is being picked up by all, about strategic purchasing. Mm-hmm. And it was quite debated heavily, because some people at the conference felt that it was a good way. Not really sure, because it's not, there's no evidence that even better planning will actually ensure that the private sector will provide.
Thank you.